Good morning and welcome to Sintra to the third ECB Forum on Central Banking. After focusing on more domestic central banking issues in the first two editions of the conference, we have chosen an international context for this year's forum: the future of the international monetary and financial architecture, which is of great relevance given the cross-border interdependencies in which we operate. We look forward to rich and inspiring discussions as in the previous years. Let me just shortly clarify our media policy. All sessions are on the record and can be reported upon live. All conversations with forum participants taking place on the sidelines of the forum are strictly off the record. For those of you who wish to tweet, whether media or here in the audience, our Twitter account is at ECB Forum, and there is a hashtag, ECB Forum Sintra. Let me now give the floor to President Draghi.
In recent years, central banks across advanced economies have been engaged in the same task, namely raising inflation and inflation expectations back to levels consistent with price stability. Each has faced conditions particular to its own jurisdiction. Each has deployed measures appropriate to its own context, and each has acted to fulfill the mandate laid down in its own constitution. And yet, the fact that all central banks have faced a common challenge of low inflation is not coincidental. There are global factors at play. And this begs the question, what is the best way for us to deal with them? At one extreme, central banks can take global conditions as entirely exogenous and set their policies accordingly. At the other extreme is explicit coordination of monetary policies. In between is a range of informal solutions. Whatever one's views on these options, what is clear is that the question of the international dimension of monetary policy is becoming more pertinent since the common factors affecting central banks are increasing. Indeed, a growing literature suggests that globalization has created a common factor in inflation developments, which goes beyond fluctuations in energy or commodity prices. Higher import volumes have increased the importance of international prices and wages relative to domestic ones, making the global output gap more relevant. In that context, there are two types of factors that are significant for the global low inflation environment we face today: more cyclical factors that have put downward pressure on prices, and more structural factors that have lowered the equilibrium real rate and slowed down the response of the economy to monetary policy. The first type of factors includes the large negative output gaps generated by the financial crisis and its aftermath, which still average 1% amongst G7 economies today. This global slack has dampened, in particular, import and producer price inflation, both of which have been weak for several years among advanced economies. Prices set by producers in the euro area and those set by producers in trading partner countries are indeed highly correlated. Also, depressing global inflation has been the slump in demand for energy and commodities linked to the slowdown in emerging markets. This has fed not just into lower headline inflation, but also into lower underlying inflation through its effects on costs and imported prices. Indeed, if one decomposes inflation for the average advanced economy, one finds that since mid-2014, there has been a notable rise in the global component linked largely to oil and commodity price falls. These various factors may originate only in parts of the global economy. Some originate more in advanced economies, others more in emerging markets. But in an integrated world, they have global effects. Cyclical weakness has spilled over through various channels into a similar challenge for all. The second type of factors is more structural in nature. They concern the global forces that have led to very low real equilibrium interest rates across advanced economies, and hence made it more complicated for monetary policy everywhere to provide the appropriate boost to global demand, given an effective lower bound on nominal interest rates. In particular, this has led many central banks in the advanced economies to engage in large-scale unconventional policies. That low interest rate environment is a consequence of global excess of desired savings over planned investment, which results from rising net savings as populations plan for retirement, from increased demand for and lower supply of safe assets, from relatively less public capital expenditure in the context of slowing population growth in advanced economies, from the secular shift from industries intensive in physical capital to those more intensive in human capital, and from a slowdown in productivity growth that reduces returns on investment. Again, those factors may not be distributed homogeneously across economies, but their effects are global because they propagate through global financial markets. With internationally mobile capital, the clearing interest rate that balances savings and investment is more a global concept than a local one. And accordingly, estimates of the equilibrium interest rate suggest that it is very low, possibly even negative, in the euro area, the US, and in other advanced economies. None of this means that central banks should give up on pursuing their domestic price stability mandates. We have demonstrated with our unconventional tools that it is possible to engineer accommodative financial conditions even when the equilibrium interest rate is low. And we have shown that this can be effective in supporting domestic demand and stoking domestic price pressures even when disinflationary headwinds are blowing from the global economy. But the global nature of low inflation does have two important implications. The first is that operating against persistent headwinds arising from abroad has forced central banks to deploy monetary policy with more intensity to deliver their mandates. And that in turn results in higher financial stability risks and spillovers to economic and financial conditions in other jurisdictions. Such spillovers are not necessarily all negative for the global economy. On the contrary, by securing economic and financial stability in their own jurisdictions, advanced economies also help stabilize other economies through trade and financial linkages. The empirical evidence suggests that the net spillover effect of the measures taken during the crisis has been positive, especially at times such as after the Lehman crash, when countries have faced common global shocks. At the same time, monetary policy has inevitably created destabilizing spillovers as well, especially when business cycles have been less aligned. The large exchange rate fluctuations between major currencies and the pressures some emerging economies have experienced from capital flows are testament to that. This is not so much a result of the measures central banks have employed, but rather of the intensity with which they have had to be used. These negative spillovers have led to a revival of interest in the topic of monetary policy coordination. But formal monetary policy coordination is complex for well-known reasons. Central banks have national mandates, not global ones, and are accountable to their domestic parliament. This doesn't mean, however, that we cannot achieve a better global solution than we have today. We have seen, for instance, how divergent monetary policies among major central banks can create uncertainty about future policy intentions, which in turn leads to higher exchange rate volatility and risk premia. That, then, has to be countered with more expansionary monetary policy, increasing spillover effects for others. We also know that competitive devaluations are lose-lose for the global economy, since they lead only to greater market volatility, to which other central banks are then forced to react to defend their domestic mandates. So, we would all clearly benefit from an enhanced understanding among central banks on the relative paths of monetary policy. That comes down, above all, to improving communication over our reaction functions and policy frameworks. The global economy could also benefit from cooperation among spillover initiating and spillover receiving economies on how to mitigate unwanted side effects. One aspect that we need to understand better is how domestic monetary regimes affect the transmission of foreign monetary policy shocks. There has been a debate in recent years as to whether the famous trilemma of international macro has collapsed into a dilemma, whereby floating exchange rates no longer guarantee autonomy for domestic monetary policy, and policy independence is only possible if capital flows are in fact managed. But there's also evidence that exchange rate regimes still matter. Various recent studies support the traditional view that exchange rate flexibility affords at least some degree of insulation from global shocks. Another aspect is understanding the role of domestic policies more broadly in mitigating negative spillovers. A large body of empirical work in recent years has shown that fiscal, macroprudential, regulatory, and supervisory policies can help mitigate the adverse effects of foreign monetary policy on domestic financial stability. Indeed, the relatively recent experience with the so-called taper tantrum in 2013 showed how differences in domestic policy frameworks shaped how severely different economies were affected by financial spillovers. In other words, it has become clearer since the crisis that the famous Tinbergen principle, which we apply at the domestic level, also needs to be applied at the global level. Policymakers need to have sufficient instruments to deliver on their objectives, and they do have them, and when they do have them, they must use them. The second implication of the global nature of low inflation is that there is a common responsibility for addressing its sources, whatever and wherever their origin. Indeed, to the extent that the environment in which we operate is more affected by the global output gap and the global saving investment balance, the speed with which monetary policy can achieve domestic goals inevitably becomes more dependent on others, on the success of authorities in other jurisdictions to also close their domestic output gaps, and on our collective ability to tackle the secular drivers of global saving and investment balances. In a recent speech in Brussels, I made a similar point regarding the interaction between monetary policy and other policies at the domestic level, such as fiscal and structural policies. And there I maintained that central bank independence could best be described as independence in interdependence, since monetary policy can always achieve its objective eventually, but it will do so faster and with less collateral effects if the overall policy mix is consistent. What I'm saying here is that the same applies to at the global level. We may not need formal coordination of policies, but we can benefit from alignment of policies. What I mean by alignment is a shared diagnosis of the root causes of the challenges that affect us all, and a shared commitment to found our domestic policies on that diagnosis. Today, for instance, the way in which domestic policies respond to a shortage of demand globally will vary. In some cases, the emphasis may be on increasing public investment. In others, on supporting private demand through more growth-friendly tax and regulatory policy. And of course, through monetary policy. The relative stance of stabilization policies will differ across countries depending on cyclical positions, but the sign of the effect on global demand needs to be positive. Similarly, structural policies that aim at raising participation and productivity may take different forms in different places, but they need to achieve the same outcome, which is to increase long-term growth rates and raise equilibrium real interest rates. Here, fora such as the G20 can play a useful, perhaps essential role in bringing about the appropriate alignment of policies. It is key that what is agreed in those fora is translated in the concrete policy actions. For example, the disappointing outcome of the G20 commitment to raise global growth by 2% with structural measures is one example of how intentions and actions can diverge. It contrasts with the more successful example that was provided by the coordinated global fiscal expansion in 2008-2009. Such fora, of course, cannot bind countries into specific actions, but mutual recognition of their common interests can act as a form of coordination device. That common interest today is a faster closing of the global output gap, more stable global inflation, higher long-term global growth, and greater global financial stability. And such an improved policy mix would help reduce unwanted side effects of monetary policy, since the burden of stabilization would be better shared across policies. For instance, in the current environment of global slack, the international spillovers from growth-friendly fiscal policies are likely to be wholly positive, since they primarily boost domestic demand in the home country. That is also true within regions such as the euro area, where there are different local output gaps. The upshot is that in a globalized world, the global policy mix matters and will likely matter more as our economies become more integrated. So we have to think not just about whether our domestic monetary policies are appropriate, but whether they are properly aligned across jurisdictions. We have to think not just about the composition of policies within our jurisdictions, but about the global composition that can maximize the effects of monetary policy so that our respective mandates can best be delivered without overburdening further monetary, and so as to limit any destabilizing spillovers. This is not a preference or a choice. It's simply the new reality we face. Thank you.
So before we start the sessions, let me just draw your attention to the electronic posters by the 10 young economists that we have selected among a number of applications like in the last 2 years, and they'll be on display. You may have seen them already in the foyer. Please take a look at them, take the time to discuss with the economists, and then place your ratings via the iPads. The results of your voting, the results of the iPad voting, will be valued together with the assessment of the selection committee, and the winner will be awarded a prize at the end of the conference tomorrow. Coming to the iPads, all available conference material is uploaded onto the iPads, which are for use in the conference venue only. They won't work outside. However, we've also taken feedback from last year that you wanted to be able to have printouts. So if you wish to have printouts of any of the materials, please ask our team and you can get that. When we start now with the panel discussions today and also tomorrow, you will have the possibility of actively participating in the debate by answering live some questions posed by the chairs. For that, take your iPads and go to the polling menu, and you will have roughly a minute to answer the questions, after which we'll show the results on the screen, and you have all the information there. At the end of the conference, we would also very much appreciate your answering a very short survey. As I said, we benefit from your comments and we improve. It's only 4 questions in 2 comment boxes, and then you can also access that via the feedback tab. I will now hand over and give the floor to Benoît Cœuré, who will chair the first session, Macroeconomic and Monetary Challenges. After the presentation of the papers and the subsequent discussions, the floor will be open for the questions. And to help the speakers, traffic lights, we do have to keep a bit of time, traffic light signal will show you the end of the time at your disposal. Please be mindful of the assigned times, and otherwise the chair will keep an eye on it, and if not, we will. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Christine, and good morning to all of you. So let me open this session on macroeconomic and monetary challenges. And let me first reassure the speakers and commentators that there is no voting on their presentations. So voting will be late for later. So that's a session on macroeconomic and monetary challenges, which maybe could have been more aptly titled from borrowing from the title of Barry's paper, which will be the global monetary order, because that's what we're going to discuss globally and regionally or locally. And that's a common theme. And Barry very rightly starts his paper saying that the notion of a global monetary order sounds somehow like an oxymoron, given what we know of the performance of the global monetary and financial system over the last 50 years. When reading this remark by Barry, it made me think of this famous quip by the Mahatma Gandhi when he was asked about his views on the Western civilization. And he said, oh, that would be a very good idea. So global monetary order, it's a little bit the same question. We'll be interested in hearing the answer. When you think about the properties objectives you would expect the global monetary order to deliver, there are mainly two. You would expect it to deliver efficient allocation of resources, and you would expect it to deliver stabilization, risk diversification, insurance against shocks, mitigation of shocks. And of course, central bankers are mostly interested in the second discussion. Well, we are not indifferent to the good allocation of resources, but this is by and large not within our instruments, within our domain, while we have to focus very much on shock absorption. And the fact that we're having that discussion today after the European and global economy was hit by a major shock is relevant and topical. I guess the starting point of the discussion is that a lot of the recent academic literature has challenged the shock-absorbing capacities of the global monetary system as it is, both in terms of flexible exchange rates, freely moving capital flows, etc. So we're very impatient to hear about your latest thoughts about the issue. You know how the sessions are organized here in Sintra. There will be the two presentations. So the first one by Barry on the global monetary order will then be discussed by Guillermo Calvo. And then we'll have a second presentation by Pierre-Olivier, actually based on a paper, on a joint paper by Pierre-Olivier and Hélène Ray, who's also here and who's welcome to jump in at any point. Not contradicting too much Pierre-Olivier, hopefully, but certainly in the discussion. That's a fairly long title that you can see here. Imbalances, safe assets, and the like. And David will discuss it, and then we'll have a broader discussion. So without due delay, let me give the floor to Barry.
Terrific, Barry. Thank you, Benoît. Thank you to the European Central Bank for the invitation to this gorgeous venue. Thank you to the European Central Bank for the title. So the title was given me. I have a tendency to take my titles too literally, but this one did provoke me into thinking whether it's appropriate to contemplate the existence of such a thing as a global monetary order, or whether we might better think of the current situation as global monetary disorder. My skepticism is perhaps underscored by the events of the last 5 days. The definition of order I found in the Merriam-Webster dictionary online is an arrangement of items in relation to one another according to a particular sequence, pattern, or method. So it's not outlandish to think about elements of an international monetary order. Given that definition, the exchange rate arrangements operated by different countries are not entirely without logic. One can perhaps discern a pattern or method in their choices. It's possible to find elements of order in policies toward international capital flows, which include in different countries restrictions on transactions on capital account, adjustments in macroeconomic policies in response to those flows, and more recently, the adoption of macroprudential measures. It's possible to discern elements of order in the provision of international liquidity, denominated mainly in a handful of leading national currencies that are traded in deep and liquid markets and used internationally. So I've just snuck in my definition of international liquidity for the discussion that will follow. And it's possible to discern elements of order in how oversight of these aforementioned items is provided through the International Monetary Fund, but also through a variety of other regional, mainly regional, entities. At the same time, clearly, we see elements of disorder. My same source defines disorder as a confused or messy state. So that's not an entirely irrelevant definition from the point of view of global monetary affairs. So if you have not read the paper, you are about to be at sea, because it's full of facts and information and analysis. It's my attempt to get my own mind around the current state of affairs and scholarship on issues like exchange rates, capital flows, international liquidity, and the global safety net. I will touch on a few highlights in my remaining 20 minutes, mainly focusing on the international liquidity aspect, which I think my discussant will then elaborate further, and some issues related to the global safety net. There is a conventional wisdom about monetary frameworks, which is that a growing number of central banks around the world are turning towards something that we might label flexible inflation targeting, or post-crisis inflation, extended inflation targeting. It's hard to find evidence of that in the global data. If you look at what the IMF reports in terms of self-declared monetary frameworks in its member countries, you will see, perhaps to your surprise, that there has been no decline in the share of countries globally that practice monetary aggregate targeting. Also surprisingly, there has been no increase in the share of countries globally. This is since the, roughly speaking, the pre-crisis period, the share of countries engaged in inflation targeting. Again, I think that's somewhat surprising relative to the conventional wisdom, relative to the fashion for inflation targeting. And surprising given the fact that inflation targeting seems to resemble an absorbing state, that once central banks adopt inflation targets, it's hard to find an example of a country that has abandoned that target. What we see in the data is a growing share of monetary frameworks concentrated almost entirely in other arrangements that are difficult to place under any of the aforementioned categories, arrangements operated by countries that either do not specify their framework or else they declare that they formulate policy with reference to, quote, an eclectic mix of indicators. So academic economists tend to be purists. Evidently, central banks do not. Similarly, with exchange rate arrangements, the data on IMF classification of de facto exchange rate regimes suggests, again, contrary to conventional wisdom, that there has been little tendency to abandon intermediate regimes since the crisis. There has been a rise in the share of countries operating so-called hard pegs, but that reflects almost entirely the accession of additional countries to the euro area as opposed to a global phenomenon. There has also, in fact, been a rise in the share of countries operating intermediate regimes due almost entirely to an increase in countries operating crawling pegs. So the conclusions I draw from this are two. Number one, that it remains the case that academic advocacy of floating, notwithstanding the prerequisites for the successful operation of a freely floating exchange rate are daunting. They include deep and liquid financial markets, supervision and regulation capable of limiting currency mismatches, and a clear and credible policy framework that does not revolve around the exchange rate, something that not a lot of countries even today can claim. Number two, I conclude that a global monetary order based on free floating is no more realistic than a return to a Bretton Woods style global system of hard pegs. I will not talk much about, talk further about de facto exchange rate behavior other than to say the approach Sheng Zhenwei, who is here, has taken suggests similarly that we are moving toward a more eclectic multipolar system where different countries manage their exchange rates in rather different ways. It can be argued nonetheless that countries have made progress, if not through changes in their exchange rate arrangements, through changes in accompanying policies in dealing with the currency crisis problem. So I show you here a time series bar graph of one measure of currency crises, conventional from the literature, instances in which the exchange rate depreciates by at least 20% against a reference currency between successive quarters and does not recover by 5% or more in the subsequent quarter. This figure I write in the slide is a bit of a Rorschach test. I think different people will read it differently. I read it as suggesting that we have made progress in terms of addressing the currency crisis problem since the 1990s. I would observe in passing that what has happened to sterling in the last 5 days doesn't rise to the level of a currency crisis, according to the definition I use, doesn't rise yet to the level of a currency crisis, according to the definition I use in the paper. More generally, though, we clearly have not succeeded in making a lot of headway on the crisis problem. So here I have updated through 2015 for 181 IMF members, the various conventional indicators from the literature of banking currency, sovereign debt crises, and growth crises or collapses. With more time, I would provide more discussion. But I do think one can read this table as suggesting that intermediate regimes, as categorized here, not independent floats, not hard pegs, are especially crisis prone. So there is a tension between that fact and the observed preference of many countries to continue to operate intermediate regimes. The paper then provides a fairly extensive analysis of international capital flows, consistent with the mandate I was given. I would make basically only two points for this discussion. Number one, capital flow volatility, variously measured. I measure it in a variety of ways in the paper, remains a first-order problem. And what seems to have changed over time is that what was once predominantly an emerging market and developing country problem is increasingly an advanced country problem as well. The same indicators of capital flow volatility that were once primarily evident or most evident in emerging markets are increasingly evident in the data for advanced countries as well. And number two, the capital flow problem and capital flow volatility problem is taking on a new aspect that we still don't understand very well. That's the corporate debt aspect. We all have a lot of experience analyzing, discussing sovereign debt problems. We have much less understanding, I would submit, of the corporate debt problem, which is the new aspect and the increasingly troubling one. Do we understand well why corporates in so many countries have accumulated such high levels of debt that now pose increasingly a problem for economic and financial stability? I would submit that the answer is no, that we don't have good models and good understanding of why corporations are now suddenly, to a much greater extent than before, getting into debt problems that pose a problem for the global system. Maybe it's the case that emerging markets have made more progress strengthening government budgets than strengthening corporate governance, which allows corporate borrowers to systematically underestimate the risks of foreign currency borrowing. Maybe international investors underestimate the risk of default by corporates with foreign currency debts when the borrower's currency depreciates. Maybe non-financial corporations in emerging markets are arbitraging the new regulations that you all have placed on the activities of financial institutions. The closest I think there is to a synthesis is that emerging market corporates have been encouraged to borrow in foreign currency by unprecedentedly low interest rates in countries engaged in quantitative easing. They are prepared to incur those foreign currency exposures, and foreign creditors are willing to lend to them, perhaps because emerging market countries have accumulated massive foreign currency reserves, which they will use to pay off those debts in the event of extreme events. So those are some conjectures, some hypotheses about what's going on here. But I would reiterate, I think this is an aspect of the global monetary order that is not yet well understood. It and the capital flow volatility problem more generally continues to give rise to sudden stops, a term given currency by my commentator, among others. Here I define sudden stops as episodes in which portfolio and other inflows by non-residents decline below the average in the previous 20 quarters by at least one standard deviation, and they stay lower, and I look at the comparison between the first half of the period for which data on flows through international bond markets are available and the second half of the period. What has changed recently, if anything? And the remarkable fact is that very little has changed. The frequency of sudden stops has not changed. The output drop that occurs in the wake of sudden stops has not changed between the first half of the period and the second half. There has been progress on the policy front. You all have done a variety of things to try to strengthen the management of international capital flows, macroprudential regulation and the like, and yet you haven't reduced noticeably the incidence or impact on the macroeconomy of sudden stops. My interpretation is that capital flows have grown and the capital flow volatility problem has continued to grow to an extent that it has largely offset the destabilizing macroeconomic impacts, any improvement that has been made on the policy front. The international liquidity problem, as I said before, I would define international liquidity as resources that are widely accepted internationally in settlement of cross-border transactions. They are held as reserves. They provide pricing benchmarks. They're regarded as reliable stores of value. They're accepted as collateral in financial transactions. They satisfy prudential requirements. They are the grease for the wheels of cross-border trade and payments for 21st century globalization. So one hypothesis, one potential explanation for the slowdown in the growth of trade and cross-border capital flows is a shortage of international liquidity. To try to operationalize that idea, test that hypothesis, you need a measure of international liquidity. So here's one. What I've done is to sum for the OECD countries, high-powered money and safe AAA and AA rated central government bonds, the bonds of supranationals like the EBRD and the World Bank, and gold in official and private hands. If you scale that by global GDP, it has fallen by nearly half from the peak at the global financial crisis, reflecting credit rating downgrades for a variety of OECD countries primarily, and the growth of the denominator of this international liquidity to global GDP ratio. Finally, the global financial safety net. There has been some progress in building it. I show you a measure of it here. The sum of foreign exchange reserves, IMF facilities, central bank swap lines, standing swap lines, and regional financial relationships. I would make two observations. Number one, while it has risen, it has plateaued. And number two, we continue to rely as an international financial community on international reserves held at the domestic level primarily as the dominant constituency of the global financial safety net. I would suggest in addition that there is less here than meets the eye. Countries are reluctant to use their reserves. What the IMF defines as the maximum reserves that countries need tends to be increasingly defined by the markets as the minimum that is prudent, which I think is a misunderstanding, but which in practice immobilizes much of the international reserves that central banks hold. The problem of IMF stigma evidently remains. That stigma problem seems to apply also to drawing on regional financial arrangements like the Chiang Mai Initiative, multilateralization, and bilateral swaps. An interesting exception is Federal Reserve bilateral swaps. Central banks are willing to actually draw on those and use them. So there is a question we need to ask about why the stigma problem that seems to apply in many other contexts does not also apply to Federal Reserve swaps. And I suggest here that a conjecture is that these are extended mainly by an apolitical entity, echoing some things Alan said last night, namely an independent central bank. Therefore, Federal Reserve swaps don't come lumbered with political conditions and obligations, whereas IMF and CMIM support comes from institutions that are directly answerable to and perceived as carrying out the bidding of governments, hence the stigma. Avenues for reform, let me suggest some highlights in my remaining minute. I think people who write about international monetary reform tend to fall temperamentally into two camps, radical reformers and incrementalists, so I'm squarely in the not-so-radical reform camp. And I would suggest focusing on the following. First, using policy incentives to address the volatility of capital flows by attempting to shift their composition from short to long term, from debt to equity, and to do that by using tax codes at the national level to make debt less attractive, changing prudential regulation to make debt and short-term obligations more costly, strengthening corporate governance, putting in place proper insolvency regimes to help address the emerging corporate debt problems emerging in two senses. Number two, continue to rationalize exchange rate regimes by moving away from the unstable middle. I wrote a book about this in 1994, and I remain wedded to that argument. I think Europe reminds us that a hard peg is one option, but that the preconditions for making it work are formidable. For the vast majority of countries, the other alternative of freer floating is more clearly feasible. I think Guillermo has written that floating is not a monetary regime, it is the absence of a monetary regime, and moving away from an exchange rate anchor requires you to put another anchor in place. Inflation targeting, in my view, is the best we have. And there is evidence that exchange rates between pairs of inflation targeting economies are more stable than otherwise comparable exchange rates. So inflation targeting can obliquely at least address some of the ills of the international monetary order. Third, address global liquidity needs in the short run. That has to be done at the national level, where credit downgrades have robbed some national bond markets of their liquidity. Those problems need to be addressed at the national level. I think international liquidity can potentially be augmented by allowing experimenting with limited allocation of SDRs directly to central banks rather than to governments, directly to central banks in a manner that will actually add to liquidity rather than simply transferring it from one set of hands to another. Another way of going about the same thing would be to experiment with limited authorization for the IMF to borrow on capital markets to fund liquidity provision. And a final possibility is to allow the fund to experiment with a pooling of sovereign bonds in the same manner that in Europe you talk about possible ways of pooling the sovereign debts of different countries in order to create a higher quality composite that will be more widely accepted and more liquid as a result. Fourth and finally, enhance the global safety net by pre-qualifying countries unilaterally for IMF facilities and trying to address the problem of IMF stigma. So my own analysis of the problem of IMF stigma is that it has to do with the lack of political distance between the fund and its dominant shareholders. I have an old proposal together with Charles Wiplos, who is here in the audience, about how the IMF might be made more independent, at least to choose its tactics, and more distance might be placed between between management and the Board of Governors. I think thinking seriously about moving in that direction is necessary if we want to address this problem of IMF stigma. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Barry. So the floor is to Guillermo for the discussion.
Well, thank you very much for the invitation. It's an honor to be here. And I really enjoyed reading Barry's paper. But I had to make a very hard decision whether to focus on the paper itself or try to just take one or two points and elaborate on ideas on which I've been thinking lately. And probably I decided the latter because that hopefully will enrich the discussion. So I will focus on the issue of liquidity. Let me see if I know how to operate this. And the first, there we are. So liquidity, and so let me talk a little bit about illusions, because that's how liquidity came into the attention of economists. And the first one is familiar to everybody. It's money illusion. It's a term that was very popular in the 30s. Irving Fisher has a book about that. And even Lucas has relied his analysis, his famous early papers, on the assumption that there is an illusion. This is W is the wage, P is the price level, the illusion is on P. So we don't know very well about P, so let me talk about P as a kind of an illusion, and that's what's been emphasized in Fisher and obviously in Lucas' early papers. Now, nowadays, we are sort of going back to stuff that was discussed by Triffin. I call it the liquidity illusion, where now we have real monetary balances there. The illusion is on M. So M is, we usually call it money in our models. And but the thing is that in practice, we don't know very much what it is. So whether we have a monopoly, as Alan was talking about yesterday or not, there is a problem with M. There are lots of copycats out there. So in the US, M was abandoned in the beginning of the 80s. In favor of the interest rate because the Fed concluded that it didn't know very well what was the relevant M anymore. And so we chose I, the nominal interest rate. And now, fast forward 2008, and we find that I doesn't work either. So we go back to M. But we really don't know what M is. We haven't done a lot of analysis on M, so that's where we are. That's the central point that I want to make. So we can talk, we see the relevance of M, but we don't understand it very well. Now, in the meantime, we've seen some liquidity illusions that were broken. For example, illustrated by the asset-backed securities, the haircut index, how it sort of jumped up around 2008. So some assets that were considered highly liquid all of a sudden became much less liquid. Now, if I apply this to the euro, the haircut, the equivalent haircut of the euro, well, I will have a picture where the haircut is not, this is from 2014 to 2013, is does not reach 40%, but it's 20%. So if I look at the euro, if I think of a world where the dollar is the center, is the king, liquidity king, so in reference to that, the ABS became a very fragile security in terms of that sort of liquidity. And when you think about it in terms of the euro and now the pound, from that perspective, assuming that the dominant concept for liquidity is dollar liquidity because it's the area that it covers, etc., then having floating exchange rates is kind of accepting that there are other assets which are important out there that could be quite fragile in terms of dollars. So if you take that perspective, right? So from that, from that perspective, by the way, the asset-backed securities became kind of dubious liquidity objects, right? So that's where I'm trying to establish some sort of parallel. But don't take me literally. I'm just saying, if you start from that angle, all of a sudden, having floating exchange rates and having these very sharp devaluations that we have seen and that are not anticipated and that is given partly by the market sometimes and even political considerations, we live in a world where liquidity is hard to define because, right, if things start to move around a lot, you have to take into account volatility, but what kind of volatility? I don't have time to elaborate on that. So this is the first point, that under the present conditions, international liquidity as a concept is hard to assess. Second, one wonders in that context whether floating exchange rate, freely floating exchange rate, if we think that liquidity is important for the functioning of the international economy, whether that's going to be very desirable over the long run. We know what the central banks do in order to perhaps preserve the stability, obviously, and also facilitate liquidity. There are these currency swaps. So here I only have a question. Is the currency swap a good substitute for Bretton Woods II? Or some sort of narrow bands and stuff like that? I have a question only. But obviously central banks have react to that. And the first reaction I heard from the Fed the other day is that they were ready to be the lenders of last resort if necessary. So there is a bit of sensitivity to excessive volatility and the impact that that may have, and one of which could be the liquidity impact. And then there are questions that Taylor, for example, suggests that maybe you don't want to go to Bretton Woods too, but if you have Taylor type rules of some sort agreed upon, that could sort of give some more predictability. I have the feeling now that we talk about floating exchange rate, and Barry mentioned something I said many years ago about floating doesn't mean anything because it simply says that you don't fix. So what does it mean to float? The poor guy in the street doesn't know what you're talking about. When are you going to intervene? How much volatility are you going to allow? Just saying that the central banks will get together and start getting this, throwing these swaps around is not a lot of information. You are making something which, if we think it is central, now if you think that the financial markets are substitute for money, that now we live in a world where money is irrelevant, that's fine. But if you need the support of liquidity stuff, then I think that's a point where we want to think more about it. I don't have an answer. Now, in relation to that, I'm sort of reinforcing this, let me bring up the issue of helicopter money, which has become very popular, and the limits of that. Now, I have not coordinated with Alan about this, but it's the same guy. As you see, so the question is why, and we talk about the dollar as something which is strong, which is quite surprising because that's nothing, that's a piece of dirty paper, sorry to say it. So how come we are so confident about the dollar? Now, of course, the answer is not the musical, although obviously it must have made it more popular than it was. Keynes has an answer, because obviously he was very concerned about the liquidity trap. And that's an answer, you can find that on chapter 17 of the general theory, that economists, I don't think macroeconomists have paid attention to this, The bottom line is that sticky prices is what makes the difference. And we set our prices in terms of dollars. We don't set our prices in terms of ABS. We don't set our prices in terms of any security which is considered liquid in the United States. It's the dollar, and the dollar is in many other places in the world. So that's the advantage of the dollar. And that's an interesting, I find it very interesting conjecture, because the more popular one is that the fisc will come and do something if necessary. But you don't need the fisc. Really, it is us who are providing the support for the dollar. So kind of jokingly, maybe we should put on the back of the not only in God we trust. But I think that kind of important. So that that conjecture I call the price theory of money, to turn it around, you see. So sticky prices used to be a nuisance. Under this perspective, sticky prices are the cornerstone of a monetary system. We have money because we have sticky prices under this perspective. If prices were totally volatile, I don't know what sense money would have, because as we have, I mean, some analytical results are there showing that the general equilibrium model, there is always an equilibrium where the price of money is equal to zero, because if it is zero, nobody wants the money, so it is an equilibrium. So that equilibrium would be present there if prices were perfectly flexible. But they are not. So, well, that's a whole topic for discussion there. I have a book coming up discussing some of these issues. So the price theory in money helps to sort of give a basis and some understanding of what that thing is so strong. And number one, but also raises other questions, because the price theory of money, even if you take this literally, if you think it is relevant, I mean, it's not everything. So if you start piling up things on the dollar, I mean, fixed income securities on the dollar, then there's a whole pyramid of things on top of that. Obviously, the dollar has some support, not for everything else. So when you think of it that way, all of a sudden, then you start worrying about whether that is strong enough to support. Could we have a run? That was Triffin's problem. Of course, under his way of thinking about this, I mean, he was writing in a period where the dollar was pegged to the gold, right? So it's an additional complication. But even if it is not pegged to the gold, the question still is whether these currencies, where I have the dollar and the euro, very strong currencies in principle, because are many, many people and firms setting their prices in a sticky way in dollars and euros, there's still the question of whether you could not be at some point overburdening the support of money. And that's where you come to think about the QE as something that may be very effective for a while, but if you keep pushing, maybe there are decreasing marginal returns to QE. And I think that's kind of relevant because it's one of the topics that we discuss. But if we don't put that, if we don't have a rationale for why that dirty piece of paper has value, we cannot go anywhere. Because that's my feeling, that much of the discussion, we talk about safe assets. I know from a practical point of view, I mean, it's quite clear we would agree that there are safe assets and so on. But what makes them safe? And if among those safe assets, the dollar bills are safe, then that's very hard to explain, except if you buy the... Now, let me just finish with a couple of things. A negative interest rate, from the point of view of liquidity, well, you know, a negative interest rate is an inflation tax. Whether that's good for the quality of liquidity, I don't know. It increases the cost of collateral. You make the collateral less attractive. So it all depends where you put liquidity, in the demand side or the supply side. And the presentation that Barry made, he referred to collateral. If the liquidity is important for collateral, and you have negative interest rates on liquidity, then you make it more costly, the collateral. And it could be counterproductive from a supply point of view. And also, just something more practical, using the interest rate, the models that we have, I think they are very misleading. They are simple, they have been very useful, but for these occasions where liquidity plays a central role, I would be very careful. The Neo-Keynesian model assumes that the interest rate goes directly into the Euler equation, that is to say, goes into the vein. There is no intermediation. The liquidity doesn't bother you. You can control interest rate and it goes into the investment function right away. But if the interest rate also reflects problems of liquidity, you may change the interest rate and not have a very big impact on decisions of consumption and investment. So maybe you had to push it down a lot and remember what Volcker had to do in the 1980s. So if going to minus 20%, of course, it's almost unthinkable. So, but that's something that we should factor in the discussion. For emerging markets, this very quickly, I agree that we have to think of ways. There is a problem of stigma. I'm almost finished, I promise. There's a problem of hard capital into emerging markets. We have some work in the past, 1993 paper with Carmen Reicher and Leo Lederman about the sensitivity of capital flows to the interest rates in the US. So the short-term interest rate in the US, so my reading of that is that capital, what we call hard capital, is capital that is looking for some way, some place to park liquidity. So that's why it is so sensitive to interest rates. So what to do about it? And I'm suggesting to think about what I call the emerging market fund, which would be a fund that would help to stabilize an index. And it could be run by the IMF. I don't have time to enter into details, but one advantage of something like this is that it may help to bypass the stigma problem. Number one, because it provides liquidity to an asset class and is triggered by the EMF. It's not that the country comes forward and asks for support. Why? What is the inspiration behind this? Is the 1998 crisis. Some people call it the Russia crisis, that triggered a very big impact on all the emerging markets. There was a lot of contagion going on there. So maybe if there is a fund that sort of stabilizes as the central bank, the advanced economy central bank did in 2008, and in my mind helped to recover quite quickly the emerging market. That did not happen in 1998. It took about 4 years for the MB to go back to what it was before the crisis. So these are my comments and apologies for taking more than my time. Thank you very much.
So Barry will have the opportunity to comment when we start the overall discussion. So let me just turn to Pierre-Olivier.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. It's really a pleasure to be here at this wonderful event organized by the ECB. And I guess my slides will be coming up shortly. Well, while they are coming up, I can tell you one thing. Unlike Barry, the title of the presentation was not given to us by the European Central Bank. In fact, we received a very general invitation and the topic to work on, which we dutifully ignored and started to work on the things we thought Hélène and I were interesting. And what was really quite remarkable is that at the end of the day, after we finished and went back to what the ECB and the organizers had asked us to focus on, we were remarkably close. So to me, this is telling us that the kind of issues that are on the front of our mind are the same as the ones that the ECB is concerned about. Okay, so now that I've... there we go. Thank you very much. So this is work I've done with Ellen Ray, who is here. And it has a long title, Real Interest Rates, Imbalances, and the Curse of Regional Safe Asset Providers, which sounds like a Harry Potter volume, but is not. What we're doing here is we're thinking about three questions that have been mentioned already in the introductory remark by Mario Draghi earlier this morning. First, what can we say about global real interest rates, and why are they so low, especially when we think about real rates, and for how long is there are they going to remain low? And here, there have been a number of explanations have been put forward. Larry Summers recently, in a speech at the IMF, revived an old idea, the idea of secular stagnation that was first written about by Alvin Anson in the late 1930s. There is also there are explanations based on the excess of desired savings over investment and the saving gluts that results from this that go back to Ben Bernanke's very famous speech in 2005. So we're going to have to say something about this. And then we're going to turn around and say, well, if we understand a little bit better what's going on with low real interest rates, then what does it tell us about the pattern of global imbalances and how they're going to evolve over time? One view was that global imbalances arose from rapid growth in emerging market economies, in part maybe in the 2000s. And so if we are in an environment of lower growth, then should we expect these global imbalances to somehow resorb themselves or not? And here we're going to have a somewhat negative answer. And then we're going to narrow down the focus and look at safe asset providers. Already today we've discussed in Barry's presentation that's touched upon the issue of safe asset scarcity. And we're going to ask specifically, when we look at regional safe asset providers, the kind of trade-off that they're facing and the kind of difficulties that may arise from this. So this is a picture that everyone has in the back of their mind. This is nominal 10-year yields, long-term rates here for the US, Germany, the United Kingdom, and Japan since the 1980s, and we all know they've been declining. We all know that the decline is not just because of a decline in inflation over that period, but also a decline in real rates. Now, if we take a longer historical perspective, here's the US real rate. This is a short real rate going back to 1870. And you can see on this graph here that this is the 1980 to 2015 period. This is a decline you just saw on the previous graph. But if we go back in time, we see that this is not the first time real rates have been low or negative. In the 1970s, they've been briefly low as well. But more importantly, they've been fluctuating. And historically, they've been periods in which they've been high and periods in which they've been low. And so we're going to try to understand what happens to real rate from that sort of long historical perspective. And so what we're going to be doing here is to shed some light on this issue. We're going to look at a ratio which we believe is important, which is, if you think of this as the average propensity to consume out of wealth. Okay, so we're going to construct a measure of aggregate consumption. We'll try to make it global by thinking about, mostly constrained by the data we have. So we'll be looking at the US, the UK, Germany, and France. That's the countries for which we can get consumption and wealth data going back to the early part of the century, and for which we're going to be constructing this ratio. And I won't bore you with the details of the empirical exercise. I'm just going to try to give you the insight for what we're doing. So this is this consumption-wealth ratio, where wealth here is a measure of not only your financial wealth, but also lands, building, agricultural land, residential housing, et cetera. So this is a graph of this consumption wealth ratio going back to 1920 here, again, for the average of these four countries, the US, the UK, Germany, and France. And you see that there are periods during which this ratio is low, and then it goes up, and then it comes back down again. Okay, now I want to point your attention to one thing, which is the period during which it was low here was exactly in the 1930s when Alvin Anson was writing about secular stagnation. And the period during which it is low again here is in the 2000s when Larry Summers was writing about secular stagnation. Now, I'm going to claim that this is not entirely a coincidence. In fact, if you think about what's driving this ratio here, you can think about, well, why would the ratio of consumption to wealth fall? Well, it will happen when there is a very rapid increase in wealth, the denominator in this ratio. And so that usually tends to follow periods of rapid increase in asset prices. So financial bubbles or very rapid increase in financial prices. So you see that in the 1920s, of course, and then you see it again in the 2000s with first an asset price increase and then the residential housing that increases. So what happens after that? Well, after that, we have a crisis. And after that crisis, what we see is this ratio, because of the crisis, wealth is going to fall, so the ratio is going to bounce back, but not completely. And why is that? Well, because at that point, the workings of this financial crisis is going to depress consumption and activity for a while. So consumption-wealth ratio is going to remain low for an extended period of time. And while this consumption-wealth ratio is remaining low, every agent in the economy is trying to repair their balance sheet, households, corporate sector, the financial institutions, the governments, everyone is trying to save. Well, you can anticipate what this is going to do to interest rates. It means that we're going to have a period of an extended period of low interest rate. And so this is why this ratio is particularly interesting when we want to look at this sort of low frequency movements in interest rates. Now, as I said, I'm not going to bore you with the details of our empirical exercise, but let's just say that we're going to be able to decompose this consumption wealth ratio into three components. One is going to be something that is due to future risk-free rates. That's this red part here. Another part is going to be something that has to do with the risky part of the return on wealth. So think of this as a risk premium component, the risky return relative to the risk-free rate. And then there's another part that's related to consumption growth itself, because that also is the numerator of this ratio. That also can influence how this ratio moves over time. And we're going to do a decomposition exercise. Here's this ratio again. I've taken logs and I've demeaned it, so it's around zero. And first, I want to show you that our empirical exercise is going to do a fantastic job of accounting for what we see in the data. This gray line I just superimposed on it, this is our predicted consumption wealth ratio. In other words, the right-hand side of this decomposition I showed you. Okay, so we're able to capture most of the movements in consumption wealth. Now, we can turn around and we can ask, OK, well, where is it coming from? And it's coming mostly from this red component, which is future risk-free interest rates. So consumption wealth ratio encodes a lot of information about future interest rates. If I ask, OK, what is coming from the risk premium, the return on risky assets? Almost nothing. What is coming from consumption growth, which is a combination, if you want, of productivity growth in the future and population growth in the future, because this is total consumption? There is a little bit there, but there isn't really that much. So our conclusion from this exercise is that we have a lot of information in this variable, and it's telling us that a lot of the movements in consumption wealth are driven by this boom-bust financial cycles that we had in the 1930s here, and we had again in the 2000s. And perhaps less so, or at least we cannot tell really for sure, how much we have coming from a slowdown in productivity growth, or maybe how much is coming from demographic trends. What we see very clearly is the financial boom-bust cycle at the global level. Now we turn around and we ask, okay, well, if this is useful, if this contains a lot of information about interest rates, can we predict interest rates with this? And the answer is yes. So here on this graph is the average of the short-term risk-free rate. This is an average for the US and the UK. Germany and France, the data is a little bit more murky because, especially in the 1920s, there were a few episodes of very, very strong price instability. But if we look at countries that didn't have hyperinflation episodes or very strong inflation episodes, this is the average of the 10-year at every point in time. And in red, this is our forecast of what the interest rate would have been at that point in time for the next 10 years. You can see that we are capturing a lot of the movement in the future rates. And what does it tell us here at the end of the sample? This is in 2011. Well, it's telling us that the risk-free rate we can anticipate from this exercise is going to be about between -2% in real terms and zero for the following 10 years, so until 2021. So the conclusion from our exercise is real rates are low, they're going to remain low. That's going to be largely driven by the aftermath of the financial crisis and the deleveraging processes that are at play in the world economy. Okay, so that's the first part of our exercise, and this is just summarizing what I just said. Okay, so now let me turn to global imbalances. So global imbalances, I'm going to start with this graph, which most of you, I'm sure, have seen in one form or another. This is a plot of current account surpluses above the zero line or deficits below the zero line, scaled by world GDP, so everything is in the same units in some sense, for various countries and regions of the world. And in red, of course, we have the US current account, whose pattern we know very well. So pattern deficits are increasing until the financial crisis, and then are receding. They're divided by a factor two, about, but they have not disappeared. So the current account deficits of the US are about slightly above 0.5% of world GDP as of 2015. Now, what happens on the funding side? Well, something very interesting has happened on the funding side. If you look at two things happen on the funding side. First, this gray bar here, those are the oil-producing countries. And what we see is the oil-producing countries, the surpluses have largely vanished. They're actually predicted to be a small negative number in 2015, according to the World Economic Outlook data. Even more interesting is the green bars here. That's the Eurozone, and this is for the geography of the Eurozone with 12 members. The Eurozone surpluses have been increasing very, very sharply, and especially since the onset of the Eurozone crisis. And what we see here is that towards the end of the sample, they are larger than the surpluses of China or Japan or almost anyone else in the world economy. Now, if you zoom in on this green bar here and you look more specifically at the Eurozone current account balances, if they come up, which they don't, okay. So I see someone is moving an arrow in the background, so frantically trying to solve the little technical problem here, but let me continue and hope that, there he goes. Well, this is the same geographical distribution of current account balances for the Eurozone countries, but now scaled by Eurozone GDP. And what you see here, the striking fact is, as of 2014 and 15, we don't have any deficit countries anymore. Or, you know, to a first order. There are tiny, tiny deficits, but they don't really matter. So we had this huge swing into surplus that's mostly coming from the elimination of the deficits for all the deficit countries back from the first part of the 2000s. Okay? Now, what's interesting is in this environment of very low interest rates, the pattern of global imbalances doesn't become less important, low interest rates and low growth. In fact, if anything, it becomes more perverse. And what we call in some work I've done with Emmanuel Fauri and Ricardo Caballero, what we say is the imbalances mutate from being relatively benign to malign at the zero lower bound. And the reason for this is if you think about regions or countries with large surpluses, what they do is they push down global equilibrium interest rates in normal times. But once you hit the zero lower bound, that equilibrating mechanism doesn't work anymore. And at that point, what takes its place is a global recession. So excess saving in some regions of the world, when we're close to the zero lower bound, can push the global economy into a recession. Okay? And not only that, but in that environment, there is one variable that takes a very important role, and that's the exchange rate. Because through movements in the exchange rate, countries or regions can try to capture a share of a world aggregate demand that remains too depressed, but they can try to capture it at the expense of other countries. So we have a very, very real potential for currency wars. Okay. Now, if we turn around and ask ourselves, okay, I told you first that we have this low interest rate because of this financial boom bust. We are in the process where a lot of economic agents want to have hold safe and liquid assets. Then let's focus a little bit on the providers of these assets. Okay. Well, first we know that if these assets are relatively scarce, then their price will be high. That's just another way of saying that interest rates will be low. Okay. Now, we also know that the suppliers of these assets are going to enjoy a funding advantage because they're providing these assets to the rest of the world. So they are going to have lower funding costs than the rest of the world. This is something that Various people over the course of history have called the exorbitant privilege of being at the center of the international monetary system, if you want. Okay? And this exorbitant privilege is actually quite sizable. In work I've done with Hélène in the past, we find that for the US, it's of the order of maybe 2-3% excess return per year on the external portfolio. But there is a flip side to this, and I want to focus on the flip side today. Well, the flip side is there must be also, in exchange for providing safe assets to the rest of the world, those countries must have a more exposed external balance sheet. It's almost the flip side. It's the flip side of the coin. It comes with the territory, if you want. And that's what we've called exorbitant duty. In other words, you must be more exposed and you must be willing to absorb losses in times of global financial instability. Now, how risky is your external balance sheet? Well, in the US, we've estimated that the losses since 2007, between 2007 and 2015, cumulative losses have been of the order of 23% of US GDP, about a little bit more than $4 trillion. And they're potentially larger, the data is not perfect, but those losses are potentially larger if you look at a country like Switzerland, and I'll come back to the case of Switzerland in a minute. So if you're a provider of the safe assets, you're going to have a huge demand from the rest of the world, and then you're going to end up with a very exposed external balance sheet. And that's going to be an unpleasant situation. It could actually even lead to a situation where it threatens maybe your fiscal capacity. And that's, in a sense, what Triffin was talking about when he was talking about the Triffin dilemma in the 1960s. So this is sort of a modern version of this. Now, what can you do? Well, one of the things you can do is you can let your currency appreciate today so as to limit your exposure exposed. Okay? So there is a trade-off here that countries are facing between an appreciation of their currency today, which is unpleasant as well, because it means that your tradable sector is going to be less competitive, you're going to suffer in terms of the competitiveness of your industries, or suffer the potential for larger losses in the future. Okay? And this trade-off is going to be worse. Both terms of this trade-off are going to be worse the smaller the country is. And so that's why I wanted to come back to this issue of the regional safe asset providers, which is particularly relevant in the case of Europe. So let me illustrate with a graph here that is borrowed from some theoretical work that Hélène and I did together in a separate paper. What I show you here on the horizontal axis is the appreciation of your currency, and on the vertical axis is the net exposure that you have on your external balance sheet. And this blue line here is the trade-off that you're facing. You could have more exposure if you decide to keep your currency unchanged. The more you appreciate your currency, the lower is the exposure you have. And this trade-off here is worse if you're a small country. That's for the small safe asset provider, the line that is out there, and the line that's closer to the origin would be for a larger safe asset provider. You don't take as much exposure relative to your own economic size, or you don't need as much of an appreciation. And the interesting thing is that if we think that countries dislike having too much appreciation or dislike having too much exposure, they will try to choose a locus that is at the tangency point between this trade-off and their own preferences. And for a large country, you can see that this trade-off may lead them to take quite a bit of exposure, and they don't need to have as much appreciation. For smaller countries, our conclusion would be that they will have to rely on letting their currency appreciate more. If they don't, then instead, if they fix their currency, for instance, they would be at a point like point C here with an enormous amount of exposure. And that's how we analyze the situation that Switzerland has faced between 2011 and 2015. In 2011, in September 2011, the Swiss National Bank announces that it wants to peg, puts a floor, which amounts to almost the same thing, on the value of the Swiss franc relative to the euro. Effectively, it's saying we're not going to let this appreciation process play, so we're going to take the exposure, both the Swiss National Bank, but also the country as a whole. And that meant very elevated levels of exposure, which eventually the Swiss themselves felt very uncomfortable with, and therefore decided in January 2015 to let the currency appreciate, moving from point C to point B. Okay, so that's our interpretation of that particular episode. But now what I want to do is I want to focus on another case, which is what we call core EMU. So if we think about the safe asset providers inside the Eurozone, so that's Germany, of course, but that's not just Germany. That's also France and the Netherlands and Belgium. Okay, and here we know the story about what happened since the onset of the common currency, which is that these countries became safe asset providers, but with an extra twist. So they didn't just provide insurance to other countries inside the Eurozone, but they also intermediated foreign capital coming from the rest of the world towards the periphery. So French and German banks would actually be able to borrow internationally and then channel these funds to the periphery countries. And that's something that's been shown very convincingly in some work that Mori Obstfeld has done with Galina Hale. Now, the Eurozone, inside the Eurozone, there is a common currency, so you can't let the currency appreciate. You're, in fact, in terms of the previous graph, you're stuck at point C there. So you have to sort of have this elevated level of exposure. Unlike the case of the US, most of that exposure was in the form of cross-border loans and debt, not equity or direct investment. And that's going to play a role in the second part of the story. Because once the crisis happens, when the crisis hit, then instead of having a market repricing of these instruments, equities going down and the market value of corporations doing direct investment being repriced, what we had is that the losses were not realized. Instead, we had a very protracted resolution process with the losses pushed first onto public sector balance sheet and then also pushed back onto the periphery balance sheet. Okay? And the consequence of that was that it triggered multiple rounds of deleveraging policies in the periphery itself. That is what is behind this big push towards surplus in the current account of the Eurozone. And so, in effect, the Eurozone as a whole became a net demander of safe asset, pushing its recession to some extent onto the global economy. Okay? Now, we do a simple calculation, which is very back of the envelope, so you know we have to take it with a grain of salt, but we ask, suppose core EMU would have the same balance sheet structure as the US with market instruments, but given its bigger size, since there is no possibility for an appreciation of the currency, what would have been the losses incurred in the event of the crisis? And we find a staggering number. We find 40% of core EMU GDP. Now, this is not a normative number. We're not saying this is the size of the losses that should be reabsorbed onto core EMU balance sheet, but we're saying this is an indicator of the kind of exposure that comes with being the safe asset supplier inside the Eurozone. And of course, that's going to create a lot of problems when you have to resolve losses that could be very, very significant. So the conclusion from this is that, you know, the curse of the regional safe asset provider, which I just described, this unpleasant trade-off between appreciation or exposure, has been at play in the EMU as well. But it has also been a curse for the rest of the Eurozone and perhaps even for the global economy. Now, I've already mentioned this, policy implications, and I conclude with that. There are three things we think can be relevant in the current context, especially if we think about this more narrow focus on the core EMU safe asset provision. First, it's going to be important to delink safe asset supply from a single country or small group of countries. And so here there are various proposals, and we are not, this is not a purpose of this paper to discuss them in detail, but all of them have a common good feature, which is that they allow some form of pooling across of resources, not necessarily of losses, across a broader base. Second point is an orderly and speedy loss-taking mechanism is also going to be important if we want to avoid these protracted rounds of deleveraging. And third, moving towards more market-based instrument, and here something like the Capital Markets Union can play an important role, is also something that would be beneficial. Thank you very much.
David.
It's a great pleasure to be here. Give thanks to the European Central Bank for asking me, and also to Hélène and Pierre-Olivier for this very stimulating paper. This comes as a sequel to a continuing flow of empirical wake-up calls, which Hélène has delivered to all of us in thinking about international macroeconomics. The conventional wisdom has been that the impossible trinity enables countries, if they have floating exchange rates, to operate an independent monetary policy and defend themselves from international risks. Hélène's argument pursued over the last few years has been that the global credit cycle makes that impossible, that countries experience excess credit growth or alternatively monetary conditions which are too tight, imposed on them by the rest of the world, invalidating the trilemma and making independent monetary policies with floating exchange rates not feasible. This has the implication of changing the way that we think about international macroeconomic policies. And it needs, those of us who think about international models, it leads us to think about replacing uncovered interest parity with a much more careful modern portfolio theory of asset allocation by investors in the face of differing risks across countries. And this has policy implications of two kinds for capital controls in emerging market economies and for international cooperation in the setting of macroeconomic policies in advanced countries of the kind that Mario Draghi was talking about earlier this morning. And I expected today more of the same and a discussion of those issues. Instead, we got something which builds upon this in a very different way, but in a way which turns out to be closely related. The first thought of the paper is to add empirical support to the well-understood ideas about why long-term real interest rates are likely to continue to be low. And the very careful analysis of consumption being low relative to wealth is something which is very useful in thinking about this tendency. We can think about the reasons that underlie these pressures coming from the deleveraging in the financial system and also from the lack of confidence by consumers and investors, as well as for the reasons that was discussed by Pierre-Olivier in his presentation. And the reasons by which these are shared across countries, we can think of in straightforward Mundell-Fleming ways, low demand being transferred in that way that we think about in a world with uncovered interest parity. But we can also, and I think it's useful to think about these forces as being shared between countries in a way related to Elaine's earlier work about the international transfer of risks through the global credit cycle. This has very important implications for global macroeconomic policy, which Pierre-Olivier talked about briefly and which Mario Draghi talked about at a great length in his earlier talk. The first of these implications is that at the zero bound, the tendency towards exchange rate warfare as a way of thinking about macroeconomic policy and attempting to push macroeconomic policy forward for individual countries is a very real one. And how to think about the macroeconomic policy circumstance in this situation was very clearly identified by Mario Draghi as going right back to the Mead-Tinbergen set of ideas on targets and instruments. In the immediate period post the global financial crisis in 2009, there was an understanding that there was a need for shared expansion, and this was first monetary, and when the zero bound was reached, fiscal, so that the use of fiscal policy was pursuing the problem of low global demand. But in 2010, at the G20 meeting in Toronto, it was decided that public debt became a target of policy. And we reached what Mead Tinbergen would have called a world with a shortage of instruments for targets. And since then, the use of fiscal policy in the pursuit of the public debt target has meant that an addition to the problem of low global demand in circumstances where monetary policy is not able to act, and has forced countries to pursue QE and the related depreciation of exchange rates as a way of attempting to push their economies in the direction required, and made more difficult by fiscal policy not helping. I've talked about these things in a paper which I reference at the bottom of this page, in a book which has just come out from Brookings. The third part of the paper goes on to talk about exorbitant privilege and duty in a world of this kind that faces regional providers of safe assets. Such providers undertake, the important point being made, they are undertaking risk transformation. The example that we all understand, which Hélène worked on many years ago, is the we now think of as Chinese depositors holding US treasuries, low yield, low risk, and US authorities and residents holding foreign assets, higher yield, higher risk. And they call this, I think rightly, a Triffin problem. But it's interesting to think about the way in which this is a different Triffin problem from the earlier one. That was often thought about as a currency problem, but I think of it really as a problem arising out of economic policymaking. In that world of the Bretton Woods system in which Germany and Japan were unprepared to devalue, to appreciate their exchange rates, and the US couldn't devalue, the countries in Europe and elsewhere faced surpluses, and they're also forced to accept an unwanted US currency as the concomitant of these surpluses. But this was a policy problem of macro policy making that led to this Triffin problem about holding excess holdings of dollars. Here we have instead a 21st century Triffin problem, which is about the capital account and emerges from this transformation of risk that we've had described for it. Clearly, we've seen in the last few days after the Brexit shock, this at work with the exchange rate for Japan appreciating, a Triffin problem facing them in the conduct of their policies. But as Pierre-Olivier has said to us very clearly, it also applies to Germany. Depositors in from abroad in Germany accepting safe assets in Germany and connected to the target two balances problem augmenting this. And that last thing about Chinese is a holdover from an earlier bit of the slide, not relevant here. It's equivalent to that. And the German asset holders holding risky assets elsewhere. But the paper, and I myself also argue, that spreading this privilege and duty to the rest of the Eurozone has very significant consequences for the GIPS country, for the GIPS countries, pushing them towards a Eurozone appreciated exchange rate, leading as the concomitant part of the very large Euro surpluses, appreciated exchange rate and shortage of demand in Europe caused by the policies adopted. This is not helpful for the GIPS countries in attempting to pursue full employment as well as the external position. And this has also imposed the bearing the burdens of the risk which this system has put in place. When the collapse came in 2010, currency devaluation was not possible. and the burden imposed by this risk became both a private sector and a sovereign debt burden in the South. And this description of the macro workings of the Eurozone creates an important additional argument to the ones which are in common play about the need for the writing down of sovereign debt in some of the southern European countries. The whole of this analysis, I think, is very helpful in thinking about the last few days. And it's important to say that I stand here embarrassed in coming from the country that has imposed this shock on the world in the last few days. And like all of us in this room, very concerned to see if we can find a way forward in dealing with this very large shock. The shock creates additional problems for global macroeconomic policy at the world level. And I talked about the difficulties of that global macroeconomic policy in a world in which there has been very significant fiscal consolidation. This adds to the need for thinking about cooperative fiscal anti-austerity policy now. And I'd pick up the point that Mario Draghi made about the G20. I was involved in the 2014 discussions in Australia that led to the 2 in 5 objective in Australia of raising global GDP by means of a mixture of infrastructure investment and microeconomic reforms that would demand promoting. That objective has been somewhat dropped, is the right way to describe what's happened subsequent to the Australian presence of the G20. I think it's important that it's picked up again by China this year. The G20 is a forum in which the kind of cooperation between fiscal and monetary policy, which Mario Draghi talked about, is possible to both discuss and achieve. But also, the second and the last part of the paper talks about the difficulties which the Brexit shock has imposed on the world, and in particular the Eurozone, for Germany, but also in the South. And the very significant move in asset returns in Italy in the last few days as a response to this shock throws into even larger relief the difficulties of need for debt write-down in parts of the Eurozone, which I think this whole framework has made important to the whole policy process has made it important to consider, and the framework which Ray and Gourinchas have shown us provides a way of thinking about. Right back to the beginning, why did we get here? This problem would have been much easier to deal with and much less likely to occur if the policies of austerity which have been adopted had been tempered and put into a framework of looser fiscal position until the recovery globally and within Europe was in a securer position. I myself think that there was a contradiction within Britain between the fiscal austerity and the ambition to win the referendum, which crashed so badly last Thursday in my country. I think there is also within Europe a contradiction between the fiscal policies which are being adopted in the north of Europe and the kinds of issues which have been presented in the Gourinchas and Ray paper to us today. These issues throw into sharp relief the need to think more carefully about fiscal and monetary cooperation within Europe as well as in the rest of the world. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, David. So we have 25 minutes or so for a discussion. I will first give the floor back to the speakers to give them a chance to comment on the comments or to answer the comments. But before that, I would like to add two remarks of my own. So I know I'm abusing my position, but that's, I guess I have one shot, and that will be it. The first remark, and the two remarks are related, and both remarks are about safe assets. And the first remark was made by Guillermo already, that there are lots of fantastically thought-provoking ideas in both papers, but my frustration would be that you're not spending that much time discussing what's a safe asset and the safeness of assets, of safe assets. Hélène once had a paper on the moneyness of money, and we could have a discussion on the safeness of safety. In particular, which kind of policy framework can contribute to the safeness of assets? And that's about ex-ante incentives. And that's about the fiscal framework in Europe, for instance. So just to illustrate, I see a contradiction between what David just said, which is we've seen too much austerity, and what you've said, which is there is a shortage of safe assets. If we want to see safe assets, we need sound fiscal frameworks. So the first remark. Second remark, which is related, I see a tension in the policy recipe or the policy toolbox which Barry put forward, which is saying at the same time, we want to see cross-border capital flows being more based on equity and less on debt, which I fully agree, and that's the whole point of our so-called capital market union in Europe, for instance, that we would like intra-Eurozone capital flows to be more based on equity and less on debt or bank loans. And I agree with that. And then, again, the shortage of safe assets. And that's, again, between the tension between ex-post incentives and ex-ante incentives, in a sense. Ex-ante, you would like more of the internationally used assets to be loss-absorbing, to set incentives right, and that's about equity flows. That also the bank bail-in that we have in Europe. So we want bank bonds to absorb losses, and that's good in terms of ex-ante incentives. And then ex-post, you regret that safe assets are not there anymore. So how do you square this? So these were my two questions. As you wish, yeah. Pierre, Barry, do you want to start?
I think our chairman's two questions really do cut to the core of the discussion. I think it's right that moving toward more equity-like claims does introduce an element of ex-ante risk that will have a depressing impact, other things equal, on cross-border capital flows, on the collateral function of so-called safe and liquid assets. There is a trade-off there, and international capital flows may be a casualty in part, and that may be a price that in our wisdom we should accept. The other point, it has come up in every single intervention this morning, is the idea that safety or liquidity is a difficult, slippery concept, and indeed it is. I prefer the older language about emphasizing liquidity, the ability to buy and sell large quantities of an asset without moving prices significantly against yourself. But I think that's what other people have in mind as well when they invoke the modern term safety. Safety and liquidity have come in for lots of discussion in the national and the domestic context post financial crisis. They're now coming in for the same discussion in the international context. I think that analytical issues are equally slippery. I think some of the problems and dangers of self-fulfilling liquidity crises that we have focused on in the domestic context post-financial crisis arise in the international context as well. They point out the need for a liquidity provider of last resort, which is even more problematic in the international context than it is domestically. Internationally, we continue to rely as an international liquidity provider of last resort to a remarkable extent on the Fed, which means that liquidity provision in last resort is available to some economies, primarily advanced, and not emerging, a long-standing problem that we've only begun to address.
Olivier?
Yeah, so very briefly, because I think Barry addressed a number of points I would have addressed exactly in the same way, but safety is something that we recognize when we see it.
When you don't see it anymore.
When it disappears, you knew it was there and it's not there anymore. More substantially, safety means different things to different economic agents or different market participants. For some people, it's about nominal is sufficient. Others care about currency. Others care about collateral. The market environment is important. And in a sense, this is something I want to touch upon, the notion of safe assets, and especially when we think about different assets issued in different jurisdictions with different currencies, the currency movements becomes part of this. An asset could be safe locally, but if it has a negative beta globally, then it may be not safe for the rest of the world. It may still be held locally. So there are different components of this demand, and I think that's an important part of the discussion. You asked about shortage of safe assets versus austerity. How can we have safe assets if we don't have a good fiscal stance? Yes, this is true. And in a sense, we could see that the efforts of rebuilding public sector balance sheet is to prepare us well for the next crisis. But we first have to get out of the current one. And in the current one, we have to be concerned about self-defeating efforts in terms of aggregate activity. The separation between contingent payoffs versus non-contingent payoffs. SAFE requires some form of non-contingency. But here I think an important distinction is between private and public assets. I think when we're talking about introducing contingencies, we're mostly talking about it, having it on the private sector side. And that's an important thing. I think the capacity of the private sector to issue SAFE assets is very, very limited for reasons that are discussed in literature and have to do with the fact that they don't have a direct backstop that's tied to fiscal resources, or as Guillermo would emphasize, to the common contract we have on ourselves.
Okay. Let me.